Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Because every word, every promise in you is yea and amen. We give you praise. We give you the glory now in Jesus' name. Everybody just say in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Jesus' name. Hey, hallelujah. 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 All right, well, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord tonight. Praise the Lord, saints.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right, how's everybody doing?
Blessed.
All right. Blessed. Yeah. Yeah. Bible says, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is what?
Yeah.
And his what?
Mercy.
Endure forever.
Yes.
I just say his mercy, endure
forever. Yes. Amen.
Let's get another table on.
All right, I guess you're going to wait for me to stand up.
Everybody okay?
Praise God. All right, I wanted to kind of piggyback on something that I presented on Sunday. And a statement I made Sunday, I want you to get, I want you to write this down if you need to, because tonight what we're going to do is going to be kind of contingent upon the statement that I'm going to make. It's God's will for a man. Everybody just say, it's God's will for a man.
It's God's will for a man.
You want us to write this down?
Yeah. It's God's will for a man to see the end results from the beginning. All right, it's God's will for a man. How many men do we have today, right?
Amen.
Men or women. God wants us to see the end results from the beginning. All right, and the purpose of seeing the end results from the beginning is that it will serve as a compass. It will serve as a compass for your life. Amen. Praise God. And we mentioned that it eliminates frustrations, which we can become preoccupied with in the present. If you can see the end result of what God promised, it can eliminate frustrations, which we can become preoccupied with in the present. Does that make any sense to anybody? All right. Okay. It's God's will for us to see the end results from the beginning. In other words, the end results are what God has promised. In other words, God wants us to allow the Holy Spirit to show us the end results of what we will be and what God wants to do through us. He wants to show us the end result. And there are some ways that God has designed for us to know exactly what he wants to do through us, what he's going to do through us, and what he wants us to be. All right? Everybody say, I have to allow the Holy Spirit to show me.
I have to allow the Holy Spirit to show me.
All right? That's something that we have to do. We have to allow the Holy Spirit to show me the end results of what God wants me to be or what God wants me to do. All right, how many believe everything that God wants us to be and do is in the Word of God?
Amen.
Amen. It's in the Word of God. Amen. I believe it was Sunday I gave you a scripture. I'm going to give it to you tonight. This is found in Genesis. Let's turn to Genesis. Genesis 15. We'll see. Genesis 13. Somebody read that from it, Genesis 13 and 14.
The Lord said unto Abram, after that Lot was separated from him, lift up now thine eyes, and look from the place where thou art, northward, and southward, and eastward, and westward. For all the land which thou seest, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed forever. And I will make thy seed as the dust of the earth, so that if a man can number the dust of the earth, then shall thy seed also be numbered. Arise, walk through the land in the length of it and the breadth of it, for I will give it unto thee. Then Abram removed his tent and came and dwelt in the plain of Mamre, which is in Hebron, and built there an altar unto the Lord.
Okay. All right, let's go to Genesis 15, verses 4 and 5. Genesis, chapter 15, verses 4 and 5. Okay, somebody read that for me. All right.
And behold.
Am I reading about that?
And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, saying, you shall not be thy heir, but he that shall come forth out of thy own bowel shall be thy heir. And he brought him forth abroad and said, look now towards heaven and tell the stars, if thou be able to number them. And he said unto him, so shall thy seed be.
Okay, verse 6 says what?
And he believed in the Lord,
and he counted it to him
for righteousness.
Okay. So we can see here that when God wants us to expand our capability to believe, then there is a certain way that he goes about it. Okay. In the example that we gave there, God chose to give a vision to Abraham. So the most effective way that God has given us to elevate our believing is through experiences. And we know that there are many other ways that we can do to change what we believe. The first one that you know about, change your environment. We know that when we get saved, the first thing God tells us to do in order to change what we believe is to change your environment. Come out from among your worldly connections, people, worthy things. Okay, because most times our thinking reflects the environment that we have been in for many, many, many years. How many believe that?
All right, so the first thing that God demands of us is to come out from among them and be separate, okay? That's 2 Corinthians 6:14-18. Now, we all remember a while back we talked about the impact that our environment has upon what we believe. For instance, like all of the words, whether they've been good or wholesome or erroneous or negative or corrupt or vulgar or hostile or discouraging or frustrating. I'm just describing words that we have heard in our environment that has actually established how we believe. Amen. Our belief represents a whole lot of stuff that we've been exposed to in the environment. How many came up in situations where you heard all types of words spoken around you and it impacted you in some form or another? A lot of times they were negative, sometimes they were corrupt. Some people were raised in situations where they heard vulgar language, vile language, discouraging, frustrating, boy, you'll never be no good. And we've come up in that environment, and all of these experiences that we have had, they shape our belief. And someone said that whatever gets into our subconscious mind first, that's the thing that's going to dominate and control our thinking. Whatever gets there first is the thing that's going to be the dominating factor in our lives. Amen. So the renewing of the mind is a process that we go through, that we're trying to what? We are trying to reprogram and to purge from our subconscious a whole lot of things that we have heard and experienced and gone through and been connected with all of our lifetime. So I was just speaking about the environmental factor, what part that plays in our thinking. All right, now, how many remember people that you live with and work with, those you drank with, smoked dope with, ran around with, partied with, and cheated with? All of that is a part of your subconscious mind. How do y'all know about it now, man? I'll just go on. Not only those who impacted you with words, but also with their lifestyles. Amen. So we have a whole lot of, you know, there's a lot of reasons why we really need to try to revamp our thinking, because if we don't revamp our thinking, it's just so far you're going to what? Go in terms of reaching the goals and the visions that you really have. Now, those that have impacted you with words, not only with words, but with lifestyle, those involved in various sexual sins who had no moral values. Now, all of that is part of our subconscious mind. So when we get saved, you know, there's a pretty good little challenge. We got to undo a whole lot of stuff that we've been exposed to through our entire lifetime. All right, those with sinful temperaments and dispositions. How many were around people that had some really bad attitudes? Nobody, okay. Those critical, those mad, jealous, hateful, backstabbers, liars, deceivers. Amen. Those ignorant, agnostic, atheists, God haters and blamers. Those full of doubt and unbelief. Those talking about Christians, believers and preachers. You know, we came up in environments where we got a little bit of everything into our what? Into our subconscious mind. Anybody can relate to any of these things I'm talking about? Those with no commitments to their homes and families. Those with no sense of responsibility. Many fathers not in home, not supporting their children. Abuse of various descriptions. Those with no purpose, no direction, no dreams, no ambition. those who didn't go to church, and those who hated school and books. So these are some of the things that we have been exposed to, and believe it or not, our thinking has been shaped by a whole lot of things. Not only the words that people have spoken around us, but also the lifestyles that we have been raised up, we have been exposed to, that were present in our household, in our environment, our work environment, and in various places. So the environment does play a major role in how we believe and how we think. Anybody say amen?
Amen.
The environment that we came up under plays a major role in what we think. Now, believe it or not, what we think, how we think, is a result of how we see ourselves and how we believe. How we think actually is a result of how we see ourselves. Now, after going through a whole lot of these things that I just mentioned, you can see why sometimes people feel so belittled, they feel insignificant, they feel inferior, they feel like they were born to lose, they feel like they're not, they see themselves as being, somebody that's not worthy of accomplishing anything. So we just want you to make sure that you understand that what we think, how we think, and what we believe is actually based on the things that we have been through and things that we have been exposed to. So I'm going to give you the second area that shapes our beliefs and our thinking is credible people and authority figures around us. These are people that we respected, that we felt like they were legitimate. They were the ones that we took our information and we call them credible people and authority figures. Like our parents, our teachers, our preachers, and people, our auntie and aunts and what, uncles. And a lot of these people, they told us a lot of crazy things. How many know a lot of crazy things passed down the family line? A lot of false information. They didn't do it intentionally. But error is error if you accept error as truth and you begin to govern your life by that error. They told you things and you received them as truth. That's why when a little boy or girl is told you won't ever amount to nothing, you are just like your no good daddy. You are telling him or her that. Okay, you are telling him or her that in his or her formative stage.
Yes.
Amen. When they're real small, in their formative stage, they hear a whole lot of that type of crap. I imagine some of you probably heard a whole lot of that kind of stuff. People talking down, to each other in the household. I mean, playing the dozen. Cussing each other out, calling everybody's names. And a lot of this stuff happened to us. We were exposed to a whole lot of this stuff from credible figures and people that we respected. And we didn't know at that time it was error, but we accepted it as what? As true. And that's the thing that we began to be governed by at a very early stage. All right, so the point I want to make is whatever gets there first in that formative stage, that's the thing that got there first. And whatever gets there first, that's the thing that you're going to be governed by. You're going to be controlled. Your belief is going to reflect that. How you feel about yourself is going to reflect that. And you're going to be a victim of that error that you receive
even when you didn't even know yourself right from wrong. Okay? Whatever gets there first has the preeminence. So if you were told as a child something and you accepted it as true because it came from an authority figure, be it a family member, school teacher, minister that told you, you accepted it as truth, and it has shaped what you believe about yourself. Amen. If you were told that in your formative state, whether it was by a school teacher, minister, any authority figure, whatever got there first became preeminent. That's the thing that you're going to be governed and controlled by until you actually experience a renewal of your mind. Renewing the mind. Renewing of the mind is a big thing. It's a huge thing. All right, now, you can memorize all the scriptures you want to memorize, but you automatically respond and make decisions in life based on your belief system. And remember, what you believe is a product of what your environment has what programmed into you, what your credible authorities have what fed you. That is going to form the way that you believe. So you automatically respond and make decisions in life based on your belief system. Amen. Your decision you make in life is going to be based on your belief system. All right. Now, without thinking, you automatically do things based on your deep-rooted value system. So you automatically respond from the things that have been programmed into you, which has become your value system, and that's what you're going to really believe. It's going to be kind of difficult to reverse it and to purge your subconscious of things that have been programmed into you, even from a small kid and on throughout life. It's going to be difficult. Now, credible people and authority figures around us, they actually help to form the things that we believe. So, number one, I said our environment. All right, number two is what? Credible people and authority figures around us. Now, if I was a preacher that taught that it's God's will for everybody to be saved, for us to be up and down, sometimes you're up and sometimes you're down, and that you can't live, I've heard preachers say that nobody can live without sin. I sin, you sin, everybody sin, and man is prone to sin as sparks fly up. Amen. So in a church where you're constantly being taught that you can't live a victorious life, then you're going to what? Amen. Absolutely what? Adopt. Amen. That belief system is going to be what firmly embedded in your thinking. Amen. So we want you to understand the things that shape your thinking, why you think the way you think. The reason why we feel like this is important, because before we can go up to another level, I know some of you are contemplating going into business and even developing businesses that you already established in. Are you really, most businesses, especially entrepreneur type businesses, they really require a person to actually to develop their belief. You got to get grounded in what you believe. You got to get grounded in it. You got to develop the things that you are believing in. So that is absolutely true. So your environment plays a big role. And remember the scriptures that we always teach people when they first get saved, like 2 Corinthians. Sometimes you might wonder why we tell people when they first get saved, come out from among them. Turn to 2 Corinthians. Come out from among them and be separate. This is 2 Corinthians, I believe it's 2 Corinthians chapter 6. It says,
verse 6, chapter 6, verse 14, it says, be ye not unequally what? Yoked together with what? Unbelievers, for what fellowship hath what? Righteousness with what? Unrighteousness, and what? Communion hath what? Light with darkness. And what concord hath what? Christ with what? Belial, or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God, as God has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Everybody read with me, verse 17. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye what? Separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. So the first thing that normally we teach and preach when people are saved, that you need to start what? Separating yourself. The Bible says have nothing to do but the unfruitful what? Works of darkness. You have to come out from among people that are actually living a different lifestyle than you are trying to what? That you're trying to walk in. Because their lifestyle, the words and the things and their fellowship and their companionship and developing close ties with them is really going to impact. And what you're trying to do, you're trying to what? You're trying to what? You're trying to purge your subconscious. You're trying to get that stuff out of your system, right? And now you have to what? Come out from among that and get among credible authorities, people that's going to what? Teach you or have a different belief system, people that are able to what? Impact you from a positive perspective rather than from a what? Negative. So you can't really develop close relationships with people that are unbelievers. Somebody might say, well, what about my job? What about my work? I know that on your jobs and things, you can't completely separate yourself from a lot of the people. And y'all get your ears full of a whole lot of stuff that you shouldn't hear, right? You don't want to hear. Right?
How would you say, what about your family?
Your family. All right. Okay,
she
your family as well. Okay.
What she gets. I was just going to say, I've got family members.
Yeah, here.
I was just going to say, I've got family members who think, because I believe like this, that I think I'm better than them.
Right.
And no matter what I say.
And you're here now.
They just believe that.
Okay. Okay, so we're saying that we got to eliminate close ties. In other words, there's no way that we can escape our closest of kin, right? Altogether. But we can. Somebody said that you can't keep a bird from flying over your head, but you can keep them from making a nest in your what? In your head, right?
Yes.
So, although there's no way to escape close ties with people that you got to connect with some way or the other, but there is a way, like you don't have to develop close ties with them in terms of run with them, right? Right? Get on the phone and what? Talk to them a long time? All right, you just got to what? Limit your what? Exposure or your contact to the best of your ability, and then at the same time you gotta build into your what? Your subconscious, your spirit, an immune system. How many know you can hear and don't hear?
Amen.
How many know you can tune people out?
Amen.
How many know you can pray in the spirit or think on these things, things that are lovely, of a good report, and things that are positive, what God is doing? And you can do a pretty good job of eliminating a whole lot of things that you are going to be exposed to on a daily basis. I mean, there is a way you can live and work around people and not be, what, overcome by their words, their lifestyles, and all that's going on with them. Because if you listen to them, boy, I'm telling you, your man will just go all over the place. They're talking about everything. Amen. The Bible says God will keep them in perfect peace when their minds are what? Stayed on Him. Amen. Praise God. Sometimes Sister Hill accused me of, she said, I'm looking right at you, and you don't hear a word. Well, we call that so heavenly matter to tell you the words we did. No, that's what we call that.
Have selective
here. All right, have selective here. All right, now maybe somebody else want to weigh in here. How do we deal with all of these things coming against us in all of these different directions? And God is consistently telling us to come out from among them and be separate and have nothing, and touch not the unclean thing, have nothing to do with the unfruitful works of darkness, but reprove them. So you're supposed to what? You're supposed to tell them and let them know that what? That I have a different set of values and I don't appreciate. How many got enough boldness to do that? If you tell them off pretty good and real in a nice way, eventually some of them will get the message. Who wants to weigh in here?
I was told we came up in the same house. The same thing mama taught you, mama taught me. Well, I said yes to what mama taught me. They said no. But so now I'm treated like I think I'm better.
Okay, well, how we do with that? And you're accused of
humility.
How do you deal with stuff like
humility?
What did you say?
Humility.
Oh, humility.
All right.
Humility.
All right.
You have to be humble.
Okay. And what
before people as they try to persecute you and prosecute you, then in a sense you have to be humble. That you know it's not right. So you're not really buying into it, but through your humility, you can show them the side of God that they're not used to. I mean, not saying that, you should let them run over you with a Mack truck. No. But you can be in an upright manner and show them that there is a love of God in you, and you're displaying that through your humility toward them, for not going against them when they're coming against you. You go with them with positive while they're coming against you with negative. So it's always a kind of a give and take in situation. When people say something negative, your spirit, most of the time, would witness to you that, no, that's not right, according to God's word. So you reverse it. You just reverse it. That's the way I do. I reverse it. If they say I'm dumb, God said I can do all things. So I reverse the negative that people throw toward me and make it a positive.
Do you always tell them that, though?
No, I don't have to, because then you sometimes you can be both of them.
Yes.
That's why you have to be.
Sometimes sometimes it's best that you just ignore.
Okay, Sister Sherry.
And that may be showing humility too.
Okay, now you and my uncles staying big, we've all kind of raised together right down the road with one another. I think they all the little witnesses. Every time we meet up, it's just like, we still going to that church? I mean, it's terrible. It really is. And it's best to just say, you believe the way you believe, I'm going to believe the way I'm going to believe.
Yeah.
You know, we're here as a family. We have to get along. But it's kind of hard.
Okay. All
right. Right in the same family. Her dad and my dad are brothers.
All right. Anybody else? That's good, Sister Sharon. That's a little challenge, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Scripture says don't be overcome with evil.
Well, and one thing she could say is, sure, I can imagine it would be hard. Are you still going to that church? Yes.
I am.
And leave it at that. Because when you engage and you start dialoguing with people, it's one thing that calls for another, then another, and another. I always said if Eve had never talked to the devil, she probably wouldn't have succumbed. But she started, when he said, did God tell you, oh, yeah, well, now, you know, and you start dialoguing with the enemy, then you give them ammunition. That's one way of handling. You just want response and go about your way. And it takes two people to debate. It takes two to argue. A person will get tired of arguing with themselves. I mean, you can't argue by yourself. You know, you just, as an audience of one. And eventually, no actors on the stage when there's nobody out there seeing. You know, so they'll eventually get quiet. That's the one way to deal with it. Just totally ignore. And granted, sometimes it's hard to ignore people when you know they're wrong. It's difficult, but that's one way you can deal with it.